The economic and ecological crisis impacting on farmers' livelihoods has been deepening with the climate change. The modern agriculture contributes to climate change and equally impacts on agriculture. The only way out to build resiliency to agriculture is moving towards sustainable agriculture, which includes a wide variety of models like organic farming, natural farming, biodynamic agriculture, and various others. While all these models are showing good results at the farm level, there is a lot of opposition and criticism from the mainstream agricultural institutions. To bridge a gap and make people understand what is happening at the ground and learning from the ground, a travel workshop has been organized by Center for Sustainable Agriculture, Action Feterna, and Wassan on 14th of November. The travel workshop is a public announcement where anyone who is interested to understand and engage with the dialogue on natural farming, the farmer, the people who have applied for this comes from various walks of life. We made a selection of these participants and engaged with them in terms of understanding their concerns. Once we got the concerns from them, we listed all the concerns and then tried to address those concerns, and then the sessions and field visits were organized for the participants so that they can visit and talk to the farmers and then see and experience themselves about what is happening on the ground. On 14th of November, all of us have met in Anantapur, Action Feterna office in Anantapur, and we had a discussion about the concerns. All the concerns were listed out, and the concerns raised by the people are grouped at in terms of the field level practices, the scientific understanding of these practices, and also the policy level issues and the programmatic implementation process. And all these the concerns were listed out, and this is a travel workshop Center for Sustainable Agriculture has been organizing for quite a long period. Earlier we have done similar exercises with non-pesticidal management, we have done with the concerns about GM crops, and on a similar line this was also organized this year. Whatever questions are addressed and then whatever concerns still remain were listed out, and a way forward was designed.
So ours was just an introduction. Ours was a block where the research, major researches were happening, and there was an women's collective. So that was the broad thing. Next is, since we went to a biodiversity conservation block, so we could see a lot of seed conservation activity happening there. So in one field, there were some 30 odd varieties of millets being conserved, there 20 varieties of paddies being conserved, multiple varieties of cotton and vegetable horticulture crops being conserved. So that was something very interesting. We went to the fields and see how this thing has been followed. There are microbial research center where they are doing lots of research on improving or bettering jivamritam, how to make it a quicker, faster, in smaller quantities, multiple other things. So that was very interesting, and the best part was it was run by the local people itself. One thing we observed is in terms of PGS and ICS systems, people are not much aware of the system that they're into. So that was something, what is the difficulty in bringing them on board, or the local agriculture officer or KVKS, what is the difficulty that the system or the program is facing? Next question is, basically about certification and marketing, since it's going to be transferred back to the farmers after the program is going to be over, how is that going to be taken forward is a question that we strongly felt. That is there something we're working on MSPs for organic produce?
We felt that AF's previous work in soil moisture conservation measures have really facilitated ZBNF in having a much smoother takeoff. So another interesting observation was a system of protective irrigation that these villages were following through tankers, which were again being facilitated by AF. It was interesting to see that there was a cultivation of arecanut and betel nut leaves, but he was applying jivamrit, and he said that really increases yield by about 25%. What really motivates a farmer to pick up a particular ZBNF cropping model For example, we'd like to see, is this five-layer model more remunerative or is it more investment-centric as compared to this Navdhanya model? So we'd like to see a kind of comparison between these and what are the different components.
Then one thing that was unique was dry sowing and pre-monsoon sowing, that along with mixed farming and broadcasting of different 5-6 types of crops. And it is very helpful, especially for probably the marginal farmers who are not able to do any kind of sowing in case of there is no rainfall or there is very scanty rainfall. And the NFS are also maintaining a lot of data and actually uploading through the ODK, and it is being monitored there. They have these experimental plots also. So that is actually a very good database. Then the output market linkage continues to be missing. The farmers, they are selling to middlemen, whoever they are selling previously, the same process is going on.
So many confusion is coming about, particularly about four wheels. So why they keep that four wheels, which is punctured or something else is there. So the reframing of this entire program, what we feel that it is very much required to give more clarity on this.
And we are working to improve local economy at village and community level. What is the role of panchayats in the whole thing?
That was village that we had got about 90 farmers had actually tried rice sowing, so we got to visit a few of those. First observation was, even within the pre-monsoon rice sowing, there were many different models. So some farmers had simply broadcast the seed, but some another farmer that we had seen had actually used ridges and furrows and had done line sowing. And the diversity of seed was also very varied. So some farmers had tried 16, some had gone, you know, up to 30 different kinds of seeds that they had used. While farmer says that it has a lot of benefits for the soil, financial benefit was a little unclear. He had not really harvested enough to generate a significant amount of income. So the ridges and furrows, so the second plot that we visited, because it was lime sowing, it was much easier to harvest and the farmer had made a significant income. The second farm that we had visited was the sericulture one. So this one was actually very interesting. So it seems that the mulberry leaves remain fresh after being cut throughout the day. So the worms eat a much higher quantity and the production of silk has nearly doubled according to the farmer. So from about 40 cages or so per seed, it is now 80 to 100 cages. And the quality of the seed, of the silk, is so high that from an average price of about 350 rupees a kg, he makes a 50 to 100 rupee premium per kg, which is again huge. So ZPNF also led to an increase in the sericulture area because the silk worms are very sensitive. So if the surrounding plots have pesticides sprayed in them, the worms don't survive. But because this entire area was making a shift towards ZPNF, a lot more farmers had actually picked up sericulture. So there seems to be a win-win situation for both tenants and owners. For the owners, the better quality of soil, so regeneration of their lands which are otherwise left as fallows, seems to be a huge motivator. And for the tenant farmers, because of the low cost of cultivation, people actually wanted to take up more land and were taking that extra time and effort to cultivate these lands. And overall, every farmer that we spoke to felt that they had nothing to lose in trying ZPNF, that it was low risk.
In Talamapuram, in this place, a good initiation in 52 kitchen gardens. And also second observation is farmers very good trained through FFS, Farmer Field School, they trained very well. In this place, 2-3 farmers there, we observed farmers as a resource person to motivating the fellow farmers. And also I observed this, our team observed very good initiative in school kitchen garden. This is one of the very good this one. And also the vegetables used for midday meals. One of the farmers we interacted with, Roshaya, earlier their chemical farming cost of cultivation is 15,000 per acre. Now under ZPNF natural farming, 13,000. And also increased slightly 10 to 15% production. The village is slowly moving towards natural farming. It is a drudgery. So they are making a jivamrita, ganajivamrita. So we have observed in this
had one scientist in our group, and in his own words, it is time now to move beyond doubt that the program is producing positive results and not be skeptical about it, but understand how is it happening. So that's the stage we are at this program, that's our observation. Okay. But we also saw that the social aspect, that the women, single women and tenant farmers, they were being involved. So it was as much of scope of converting the fallow lands with social innovation. We have also seen that the health impact is positive. Farmers don't complain of diseases. Their expenses on health expenditure has gone down. So the role of CRPs has been proactive and central. And we saw that in these two villages there were women CRPs, and that makes it especially important because they influence other women in the villages positively. There is a village level resource center located in the village of Kamrapalli, and this is something the farmers found it good. They could approach the center with their questions and suggestions, and perhaps the program can replicate it in other villages. The comparison of ZBNF or natural farming should be done with unsubsidized chemical farming, and other impacts of social innovation and positive impacts on health expenditure should be considered. So that needs to be projected out in a documented fashion, the program. So how do we listen well to the parties that are not conforming to the ZBNF, which includes the dropouts? That was the next suggestion.
ఇంకా వాళ్ళు రైతు ఉత్పత్తిదారుల సంఘం ఏర్పాటు చేసుకుని వాళ్ళు పండించిన పంటల్ని వాళ్ళు మార్కెటింగ్ కూడా చేసుకుంటున్నారు. ఇంకా రైతు ఆత్మహత్యలు అనే ఇంతకు ముందు ఎన్ని రకాల ప్రయత్నించినా తగ్గట్లేదు. మన జడ్పీఎన్ఎస్ వల్ల రైతు ఆత్మహత్యలు తగ్గితే నేను
ఆశిస్తున్నాను. విషయం ఏంటంటే ఈ ఐసీఆర్పీలు ల్యాండ్లెస్ కౌ రైతులతో ఓనర్లతో లింక్ చేస్తున్నారు, వాళ్ళకి తక్కువ కౌలుకు వచ్చేటట్లు చూస్తున్నారు. అది చాలా పాజిటివ్ విషయం. కానీ ఇంకా కౌలు రైతుల రైట్స్ హ్యాంగిల్లో కొంత ఐసీఆర్పీలు వాళ్ళకు సిసిఆర్సీ కార్డులు ఇప్పించడం కానీ, వాళ్ళకి బ్యాంక్ లింకేజ్ కానీ, ఈ విషయంలో కూడా కొంత జెడ్బీఎన్ఎఫ్ స్టాఫ్ మంచి రోల్ ప్లే చేస్తే బాగుంటుంది అనిపించింది.
Are you facing labor problems because of adoption of natural farming? And farmers were repeatedly saying that agriculture itself is full of tasks. Why ask us specifically about ZBNF? If you are a good farmer, be prepared to work hard. That's the attitude generally. But they were talking about how the preparation, all the input preparations are offset by the fact that de-weeding is much more easier for laborers. You can do it faster with lesser number of laborers and the cost comes down because the soil becomes loose. And the wheat growth itself is low, and this was mentioned by many farmers.
If we are not part of designing team, how to shape up this whole thing kind of thing? How we go? Because now I think we should also put the broader picture in mind. So about the processes, so the science, practice and processes and policy. Basically, if that has to happen all over, then what kind of systems we need to put in? Probably, say instead of, like you said, ICR has to learn, and then we also have to learn from the ICR's learning. So what system can help towards that? These four things we thought the group should do. And so this is not only from yesterday's observation, but also from your own learnings, I think is what is required. We were a certain team, now we have 34 people to work with us. Probably we run similar processes. You also run similar processes. So we, each one, if we can do similar kind of exercise of getting people to understand it in a better way, probably it will go on kind of thing.
Yesterday that findings have been similar across different states, where farmers have largely reported that they are satisfied and happy with ZBNF. They have observed yield difference is not so much, maybe 5-10% here and there, but most of the farmers have reported higher profitability and better income realization. That I think it's very important that civil societies own this movement to help it scale. Of course, we will need political will and government support.
NRCs, universities and ICARs, what we felt was that we have to identify champions in these stakeholders. We really need to get the champions of the establishment who believe in this cause, believe in this movement, and give them a wider voice so they can convince their peers and their institutions to take this a lot more seriously. We can create these problem statements for each crop, so classify it by each crop and take it to our champions for that crop and say that, can you get your students or PhD or can you work on these problem statements?
So the program needs to invest in finding alternatives for these, say what other kinds of mulch if you don't have biomass and what is the solution and things of that sort. So these small scale innovations that can add that actually need investment. The RSS team should also be linked to the revenue department, that suicide families, farmer suicide families or high distress families also need to be identified on a proactive basis so that they are included. Inputs also need to be available for purchase. Also that needs to be subsidized as well. So
thing is, can there be information be shared as to what kind of research is already going on? And second is, as a result, if we know what are the gaps and what additional research is required, because we understand that I think primarily as of now it's institutions from abroad that are leading this research. So can local research institutions also be involved in any future research that is being planned, and especially the state agriculture research institutions? There will obviously be a lot of administrative data that is being captured already in this program. So if this kind of MIS data could be shared publicly, then this could also help researchers better understand what is going on, and not just researchers, anyone who is interested can better understand how this program is being implemented.
So I think even if it generated new set of questions, it's quite good. So it clarified some of the questions you had, but it generated new questions. That shows actually it's a constructive engagement. So how do we answer the new set of questions? Probably will be our action plan kind of thing.
So let's do this by show of hands, okay? If most of you think that a question is answered, just raise your hand and I'll color code it. What do farmers at large really think about ZBLF? If you think you have found some semblance of answer, lift your hand.
When we started the program, the idea was that we have acute farmers' distress, and therefore, what needs to be done? And not there are of course the solutions were symptomatic. That means if there's a drought, there is crop failure. And in the measures, policy measures for the welfare of farmers. So the minimum support price is announced, but there are not enough procurement centers to ensure that any farmer in distress can actually get the MSP. So if you see the whole ecosystem around a farmer, there are a lot of gaps, and many of them are addressing symptoms. Many of them are actually symptoms of or fallouts of what has been happening to our soils, water, for a long period of time. We have been ignoring those signals. The rate of soil erosion, lack of water infiltration, leading to more crop failures. So when long ago, it's actually what you are seeing today, actually dates back to an intervention, in fact, CSA or its precursor, CWS, started in one village in Khammam district, showing that it's possible to get rid of chemical pesticides in a cotton crop. And then, at that time, I was leading the women self-help group program. So we said, you have to change the whole village if you have to change one farm. So that is the role of the civil society organizations working there, the role of the women's self-help groups and federations. At the same time, I like what one of the groups said, there are champions among these stakeholders who are also saying that, okay, we are doing our work, but we are not finding a solution. So there has to be a very proactive collaboration between the champions in the formal institutions, the CSOs, and the farmers' organizations. But here in Andhra Pradesh, the government is supporting the program and supporting with resources, and very important, to give flexibility to ourselves. We have a partnership with a philanthropy, Azim Premji Philanthropy, that actually enabled us to create a space within the government to be more flexible, to get the desired kind of resources, the partnership with resource NGOs. So all that became possible with the support of the philanthropy, and I think Mr. Palekar's four wheels, we take them as the starting points, because we started this program with around 900 such champion farmers who emerged out of the previous program. In the knowledge dissemination system is a very important role played by the resource NGOs. Each one is bringing their expertise into the program. But the fourth pillar is about community institutions. And for me, this is very, very important. Yes. So one of the gaps that we noticed was that lack of a support system when a farmer is making this transition. And that is where a farmer producer organization or a women self-help group, they provide that support to new institutions. And when we looked at the science behind the BNF, we said there are certain inputs, there are outputs, but how exactly the inputs are getting into, converted into outputs, we said is a black box. There can be many hypotheses. So our part, what we are doing in the science part, is unpacking the black box. And tenants, definitely we have got a breakthrough in terms of both the commercial banks and the Stri Nidhi, which is set up for the women SDGs in Andhra Pradesh, agreed to create a separate loan product for tenants. As long as they are coming through the women self-help group, so there is no insistence, no requirement of any documents. It is basically the declaration of the self-help group. And what technology will bring back the soil organic matter? But my only appeal is, yes, there is a small ray of hope. There could be problems with this. There is no certification, there is no marketing. What will happen to the cow? What will happen to this? What will happen to that? Yes, those problems are there. They are not such huge problems. They can be tackled. But can we make this process stronger, bigger? Because with just 0.5% farmers, how are you going to change the whole crisis that we are talking about?
So many things have been added to what Palekar has been even today he is preaching, if we see in our work in Andhra Pradesh on the CRZBMF program. Pre-monsoon rice sowing was not part of a typical JBMF. This was an invention that has come like that. Five-layer models is not come from there. Rain-fed agriculture, rain-fed horticulture, integrating animals and also trees and annual crops into a farming system at the family level. These are not the ones that has just come like that. This have come by the practical experience of many of the NGOs, not only ours, many of the NGOs. And this system has been, at least from 15 years by now, minimum 15 years this has been in practice. Not only that, this has been in practice. In 15 years, how is that the whole of country, no university has taken it seriously?
When we look at water productivity in national farming, so our way of water is different. We are not looking at water, we are looking at moisture, we are not looking at ton cubic meter, diesel, we are not looking at diesel meter, we are looking at mm of water. How much water the plant roots will take? How can we increase efficiency at the interface of plant roots and then the soil? Now that is where the efficiency comes in.
Let's listen to people. Let's see where we stand against each other's concerns. So it's not that we only have a concern. I strongly believe all of you have concerns. That's how we all are here. So if all of us have a concern, we should both talk to each other. Why should we actually fight with each other? Right?
I think that's the core premise under which this whole workshop was organized. And when you are, so how do we actually narrow down the distance between us? I think that's the core purpose of this workshop. More people in this country, they necessarily need not be part of the program. See, need not be part of the program. So in your own way, you can actually take it up as a champion. Because we need more champions, more people thinking about it, making it as their life goal. I think that let's look at the national level where we can engage further and then take it forward. So thank you very much for coming and then taking all the things. And I think it was wonderful for us to learn. And each day we are learning more.
Most of the concerns raised by the participants can be grouped into, could be grouped into policy level, field level, and implementation level concerns. And in terms of most of the concerns were about the scientific understanding of the practices, whether the practices promoted are an ideological based without any scientific basis, or is there any scientific basis kind of thing. So most of the concerns when we looked into and then when we dialogued, we could diagnose that they come from old school of thought about plant nutrients being supplied from external sources without looking into the biological nutrient sources and recycling of nutrients from various sources. The new agroecological approaches largely depends on improving the soil health so that the nutrients can be mobilized from the soil. So this paradigm couldn't be understood properly. And in terms of using farmers as resource person, there were a lot of concerns in terms of how the extension system can be strengthened. And after talking to the farmers at the field level and after seeing the whole experiences at the farmers level, people were very much convinced about the alternate paradigm of community managed extension.